Culture wars are probably as old as civilization. Wherever there is one group wishing to impose social norms, another group will reject them. In America, our culture wars have reached a boiling point. But how did we get here? First, I'll give you my theory, and then I'll give you some facts to back it up. There are a lot of people in this country who want to do offensive stuff, like say the N-word, or carry high-powered rifles into Walmart. Then some other people came along and said, "You can't do that." So they took it behind closed doors for a while. Then some people released a list of 700 genders that you have to respect, and the other people said, "If you get to do that, then we get to say the N-word in public with our guns." And then chaos ensued.
Pepe's become kind of a symbol.
To limit our time, I'm going to start off in 1925. The culture war at that time was mainly between more fundamentalist Christians and those who were less religious and more intellectual. One teacher in Tennessee tried to teach his class about the theory of evolution, only in doing so, he was breaking state law. Christian creationists took him to court in what would be called the trial of the century, the Scopes Monkey Trial. He was convicted, but an appellate court overturned the ruling. Evolution, it seemed, had won. The 1930s saw economic liberalism as a way to fight the Great Depression, and the 40s were spent fighting and recovering from World War II. In the 1950s, In God We Trust was printed on all American money as a way to bring religious and national pride together to overcome the dreaded godless Soviets. In God We Trust also became our national motto, and Under God was added to the Pledge of Allegiance. In the 1960s, the hippies took center stage. Free love and free drugs were abundant, and young people wanted to abandon the Protestant ethic of their parents. This era saw the left engage in transgression to resist the dominant culture, stemming from groups like the Situationist International. Books inspiring this movement were Guy Debord's Society of the Spectacle and Raoul Vonnegut's The Revolution in Everyday Life. In the 1970s, Nixon made an economic appeal to the left, but a cultural appeal to the right, against the hippies. The Joy of Sex was published in 1972 as part of the sexual liberation movement. In the 1980s, Reagan took charge and promised to bring America back to a mythic time of glory.
Government is not the solution to our problem. Government is the problem.
In the 1990s, Bill Clinton came to power, abandoning the old left and promising to forge a middle way between left and right. Rush Limbaugh went mainstream during this time, pushing the culture to the far right.
Militant feminism is what's defined as mainstream feminism.
The 1990s saw a rise in male rampage films like American Psycho and Fight Club that tapped into something primitive within masculinity. The modern iteration of the culture wars began with Pat Buchanan and his book Death of the West. In it, he calls neoconservatism a globalist, interventionist, open borders ideology. In the 1992 Republican National Convention, Buchanan gave a speech where he said,
"George Bush is a defender of right to life and a champion of the Judeo-Christian values and beliefs upon which America was founded. Bill Clinton and Al Gore represent the most pro-lesbian and pro-gay ticket in history, and so they do. This is radical feminism. The agenda that Clinton and Clinton would impose on America. Abortion on demand, a litmus test for the Supreme Court, homosexual rights, discrimination against religious schools, women in combat units. That's change, all right. But that's not the kind of change America needs. It's not the kind of change America wants. And it's not the kind of change we can abide in a nation we still call God's country. There is a religious war going on in this country. It is a cultural war as critical to the kind of nation we shall be as the Cold War itself, for this war is for the soul of America."
When the AIDS crisis broke out, Buchanan wrote, "Poor homosexuals, they have declared war upon nature, and now nature is exacting an awful retribution." George W. Bush's promise was to bring a compassionate conservatism, which in practice meant cutting taxes without budget cuts, creating huge budget deficits. The 2004 election was almost all cultural, with Bush and Kerry agreeing on most issues of foreign and economic policy. 2008 ushered in Barack Obama with a promise of hope and change.
I am absolutely certain that generations from now, we will be able to look back and tell our children that this was the moment when we began to provide care for the sick and good jobs for the jobless. This was the moment when the rise of the oceans began to slow and our planet began to heal.
His shining economic achievement, the Affordable Care Act, was a recycled plan from the Heritage Foundation. The 2016 election carried with it years of economic and social angst, and frustrations over who would carry the mantle erupted into fights. This video is based on the book Kill All Normies by Angela Nagel. It is one of the best books I've ever read on modern political culture. You can check it out in the description below. The pursuit of cultural goals over political ones is known as metapolitics. Andrew Breitbart, founder of the Breitbart website, made the claim that politics is, quote, downstream of culture. These ideas come from the Italian Marxist Antonio Gramsci. Gramsci was in prison when the fascists took power in Italy. In his prison notebooks, he wrote that changing culture was the only way to bring about political change. Some suggest that the right won the economic war in America, while the left won the culture war. They are not happy about either of these things. Let's look at the players in the culture war, starting with the right. 4chan is a website and forum used by rebellious trolls. There you can find lots of discussion on anime and some really weird porn, like disturbingly weird. It was here that the hacktivist group Anonymous was formed. At first, the left praised 4chan, while the right discouraged them, but their politics quickly changed. The site became rabidly anti-feminist and even anti-woman. The popular meme that emerged from here was Pepe the Frog. This became used to display feelings of sadness, happiness, mischief, or just to troll. One group to come out of 4chan and other sites is betas, or incels, people who say that they are involuntarily celibate. There's a deep longing for connection, combined with a hatred for the women who rejected them. Incels and betas are part of a large group known as the manosphere. It includes incels, men's rights activists, and pickup artists. All are extremely anti-feminist and anti-social justice warrior. Men's rights activists have some legitimate complaints about how fathers are treated unfairly in child custody disputes, and how law enforcement often doesn't take domestic violence against men seriously. This alone can't explain the deep hatred for women, and beliefs about how all women are secretly manipulative and seek to trap men and gain power over them. Out of this group comes the MGTOWs, or Men Going Their Own Way, a group that has completely sworn off women. Next comes the pickup artists. Their goal is to sleep with as many women as possible using the principles of The Game, a book written by Neil Strauss. The alt-right, led by Richard Spencer, are a group of well-dressed, well-educated white nationalists. Spencer is well-groomed and doesn't fit the stereotype of a typical internet neckbeard. After the election, he gave a speech for the National Policy Institute.
Hail Trump! Hail our people! Hail victory!
Spencer's goal is a, quote, peaceful ethnic cleansing to create a white ethno-state. The alt-light, as Nagel calls them, were led by Milo Yiannopoulos. This group does not explicitly call for an ethno-state, but believes in transgression towards feminists, Black Lives Matter, and SJWs. Milo's campus tour was called the Dangerous Faggot Tour.
Feminism is cancer. Thank you very much.
More traditional conservatives in this group included Ben Shapiro and Jordan Peterson. Nagel notes, within the radical right libertarian pro-tech tendency, common preoccupations include Bitcoin, seasteading, Peter Thiel's idea to create a separate state off the coast of the U.S., and rightist elite applications of transhumanism. Now to the left. First, there's the traditional economic left, which includes everyone from Bernie Sanders progressives to full-on socialists. These people value universal health care, want higher taxes on the rich, and push to get money out of politics. This group gathered online in Bernie Sanders' dank meme stash, a group on Facebook. The other group, who Nagel calls Tumblr liberals, refer to the economic left as Bernie bros or brocialists. Social issues are important to the economic left, but they tend to see them through an economic lens. For example, They acknowledge that ethnic minorities, women, and LGBT people are all oppressed, but believe it is because each of these groups are statistically poorer than average. Tumblr liberals are obsessed with oppression, but tend to ignore economic oppression. They focus on social factors, such as microaggressions, things people say that could be subtly harmful. The ideal person, who is always allowed to speak, is disabled, transgender, woman of color. While the old libertarian left sought to dismantle hierarchies, the Tumblr liberals want to create new hierarchies where the most oppressed rule. There is a fascination with gender, which is seen as a social construct. They believe that there are many more genders than society has previously recognized. Liberal sites like Upworthy and BuzzFeed fed condensed news to viewers with their own twist. By 2015, BuzzFeed was getting more shares on Facebook than Fox News or the BBC put together. Nagel says that sites like Everyday Feminism, Jezebel, and Salon delivered a strange mixture of ultra-sensitivity, sentimentality, and what was once considered radical social constructionist identity politics. These sites ran articles that could almost have been a parody of themselves, such as 8 Signs Your Yoga Practice is Culturally Appropriated, or Men Can Be Feminists, But It's Really Hard Work. The progressive left includes shows like The Young Turks, who have over 3 million subscribers. The online publication Jacobin moves even further to the left, covering openly socialist topics. The progressive left also contains podcasts such as Chapo Trap House, which satirically makes fun of establishment conservatives and liberals. So how did the recent culture wars start? Some say that it all started with a gorilla named Harambe, who was shot after a child fell in his enclosure, releasing an explosion of joke sympathy for the gorilla, culminating in memes featuring "Dicks out for Harambe" as a slogan and "Bush did Harambe." A common prank on 4chan became RIP trolling, or harassing the family of someone who had recently died. The online right began using the swastika as a joke, but this attracted actual Nazis and white supremacists, so it became hard to tell who was serious and who was being ironic. French writer Maurice Blanchet used the phrase, "The greatest suffering of others always counts for less than my pleasure." This has become a philosophy of the online right. A common response to females who try to post in these male-dominated communities is, "Tits or get the fuck out." Feminist game designer Zoe Quinn made a game called Depression Quest, where you treat your character's depression. The male gaming community launched a horrendous attack on her, including revenge porn from her ex-boyfriend, and they threatened her with rape, death, and made her address public. Other feminist gamers were attacked in similar ways. This became known as Gamergate, and got so vicious that it was banned from the already extreme 4chan. The discussion migrated over to what became more of the Wild West of the internet, 8chan, also known as Infinity Chan. There were some right-wing women in this sphere who argued against feminism, but most, as Nagel describes, consisted of apolitical gamers, South Park conservatives, 4chaners, hardline anti-feminists, and young people in the process of moving to the political far right without any of the moral baggage of conservatism. These are the people who elevated Milo to stardom. Nagel states, "Ultimately, the Gamergaters were correct in their perception. The revived feminist movement was trying to change culture, and this was the front, their beloved games, that they chose to fight back on." 4chaner Chris Harper Mercer led what came to be known as the Beta Rebellion, when he killed 9 and injured 9 of his fellow students at the local community college. Chris posted on 4chan before doing this that women had always rejected him, and now he would exact his revenge. 4chan was delighted, calling this the beginning of a beta uprising. 4chaners also gave warning to their community before shooting up a Black Lives Matter rally, posting, "We just wanted to give everyone a heads up on poll, stay white." The so-called virgin killer, Elliot Roger, went to a University of California Santa Barbara sorority house with the intention of shooting young women inside. When he failed to gain entry, he shot random passersby, killing mostly men. Roger then shot himself in his car. Roger had a contempt for interracial marriage, seeing women with men he viewed as genetically inferior to himself. 4chan dubbed him the beta to end all betas. One 4chaner changed his name to Elliot Roger is a God. Suicide is a common topic among 4chaners and is often glorified. If someone posts that they are suicidal, most will encourage him to do it. Nagel calls this a dark spectacle in which pity is replaced by cruelty. Friedrich Nietzsche is one of the primary philosophical influences of the new online right. Nietzsche described Christian principles as a, quote, slave morality. The Overton Window describes the mass political consciousness of what is acceptable in society. Both sides have been trying to shift this window in their respective directions. The left slogan of 1968 was, "It is forbidden to forbid." Today, the liberal left seems to want to forbid almost everything. The Tumblr liberals reacted to the new right by becoming more and more anti-male, anti-straight, anti-cisgendered, and anti-white. Common phrases thrown around were, "All men are trash," or "All white people are racist." Oftentimes, someone posting in a group would be attacked or kicked out simply for not having a badge of oppression. In 2015, Facebook rolled out over 50 new gender options for its users to choose from. Around this time, safe spaces and trigger warnings became something that was discussed on college campuses. Those who violated these rules would be no-platformed or refused an opportunity to speak. Even Hillary Clinton started using terms like check your privilege and intersectionality.
I've been saying this for a while now. I'm going to keep saying it because I think it's important. We white Americans need to do a better job.
In 1949, Simone de Beauvoir argued, one is not born, but rather becomes a woman. And in 1990, Judith Butler argued that gender was a social construct. These have been some of the biggest influences on Tumblr liberalism. A few Tumblr genders include anxiogender, a gender affected by anxiety, cadence gender, a gender that is easily influenced by music, dimagender, a gender closely related to demons or the supernatural. Some identify as otherkin, or partially or entirely non-human. Nagel goes on to describe adults who identify as babies and able-bodied people who identify as disabled people to such an extent that they seek medical assistance in blinding, amputating, and otherwise injuring themselves to become the disabled person they identify as. Columnist Arthur Chu tweeted, "As a dude who cares about feminism, sometimes I want to join all men arm in arm and then run off a cliff and drag the whole gender into the sea." Columnist Lori Penny tweeted after Trump's election, "I've had white liberal guilt before. Today's the first time I've actually been truly horrified and ashamed to be white." In his essay, Exiting the Vampire Castle, Marxist critic Mark Fisher described liberal Twitter as miserable and dispiriting, saying that they were bullies who had a witch-hunting moralism. Fisher was taunted by Tumblr liberals after his death. Nagel says the call-out culture has a mix of performative vulnerability, self-righteous wokeness, and bullying. Nagel describes the culture of virtue signaling as an economy, where virtue is the currency. A blogger or columnist can make or break their career based on the accumulation of virtue. At some point, those on liberal Tumblr and Twitter believed their currency was being devalued by inflation. Too many people were being righteous. The solution, it seems, was to purge the unworthy of their virtue, meaning other leftists. The easiest targets were economic leftists, who did not buy into all the cultural virtue. In 2016, a 2-year-old boy was killed by an alligator at Disney World in Florida. Liberal Twitter attacked the grieving father over his, quote, white privilege. After the shooting at a gay nightclub in Orlando, the Tumblr liberals created a storm of confusion over how to react. Was it his allegiance to ISIS that had caused the attack, as the shooter claimed, or was it mental illness? Others responded that it would be ableism to blame the shooter's mental illness. The idea of a trigger warning started off with good intentions. It was designed to give warning before saying something shocking that might upset a person with PTSD or a person who had been raped. It devolved into a hysteria towards any unpopular idea, such as the belief that there's only two genders. In 2015, Mariam Namazi, an Iranian socialist and feminist, went to speak at Goldsmiths University in London. Because she was an ex-Muslim and passionately non-religious, the Islamic Society decided to protest her. Western liberals sided with the Islamic Society. Goldsmiths University's feminist and LGBT groups supported the Islamic Society, who are vehemently anti-gay. Physics professor Alan Sokol wrote a satirical paper in which he explained how gravity, that's right, gravity, was a social construct, and submitted it to a postmodern cultural studies journal, Social Text. The title was Transgressing the Boundaries Towards a Transformative Hermeneutics of Quantum Gravity. Social Text published the paper. Sokol described it as being liberally salted with nonsense. YouTube became filled with videos bearing titles like SJW Cringe Compilations. Milo built a short-lived career out of trolling the absurdities of Tumblr liberals' identity politics. The Proud Boys was founded by Gavin McGinnis and supports traditional values, conservative economics, and anti-masturbation, or no wanks. Level 1 Proud Boy is simply declaring yourself a Proud Boy. Level 2 Proud Boy means no wanks, except for once a month. And you get a beating until you can name 5 breakfast cereals. Level 3 involves a Proud Boy or no wanks tattoo. Watching the initiation, it seems like they want to start a fight club but don't actually want to get hurt. McGinnis, former editor of Vice magazine, had to step down from an advertising firm after stating that the dominant media ideology teaches women to be fat, single, and childless, and after he published an article titled, Transphobia is Perfectly Natural. Lauren Southern, a conservative anti-feminist, attended women's rallies with signs such as, There is no rape culture in the West. At another protest, she shouted,
Sorry guys, there's only two genders, female and male.
She was immediately met with a container full of urine poured over her head. Ben Shapiro was one of the first to leave Breitbart over its move towards anti-Semitism. After the birth of his second son, Milo tweeted a photo of a black baby to Ben, writing, Prayers to Ben, who had a baby come out half black and already taller than he is. This is a reference to the common fascination of cuckolding among the alt-right, where a white man watches his white wife have sex with a black man. Conservatives who do not take a strong stance against immigration are called cuckservatives, because they are allowing their people to be cucked by inferior races. Steve Bannon, who helped build Breitbart, later became chief strategist for Trump's White House. Nagel says, it appears as though in the online culture wars, those heeding the ideas of the left most closely, from Chomsky's idea of manufacturing consent to Gramsci's theory of hegemony and counter-hegemony, and applying them most strategically, were the right. A popular activity for the transgressive right on International Women's Day was the triggering, in which they would post the most offensive things possible against women and see who got triggered. Another big influence on the new right is Alex Jones of InfoWars, who is known by the Southern Poverty Law Center as the most prolific conspiracy theorist in contemporary America.
I don't like them putting chemicals in the water that turn the friggin' frogs gay! Do you understand that? Serious crap!
Nagel sums up the culture of both sides by saying, in modern politics, liberal leaders are forgiven for drone bombing as long as they're cool with gay marriage. While on the right, enacting policies that devastate families and stable communities was cheered on at any cost, as long as it dealt a satisfying blow to the trade unions, as we saw during the Reagan and Thatcher years. Nagel says, the rise of Milo's 4chan-influenced right is no more evidence of a resurgence of conservatism than the rise of Tumblr-style identity politics constitutes a resurgence of the socialist or materialist left. Although Milo and the new right often attack postmodernism, they too are a product of it. Their fake irony, playfulness, and references to culture could be placed among the situationists of the 1960s. There's an obsession in the manosphere with being an alpha male and avoiding being relegated to the status of beta. 4chan's language for the ideal man who does all the mating with females is Chad Thundercock. His primary target is the ideal female, Stacy. 4chan and male-dominated corners of the internet refer to what they see as shallow and vain women with mainstream tastes as normies and basic bitches. In the manosphere, groups like Men Against Sexism would be described by the rest of the manosphere as manginas. The manosphere has been influenced by Warren Farrell's book The Myth of Male Power and Neil Linden's book, No More Sex War, The Failure of Feminism. Nagel describes the red pill form on Reddit as a, quote, relentless flow of sexual frustration, anxiety about evolutionary rank, and foaming at the mouth misogyny full of descriptions of women as worthless cunts, attention whores, riding the cock carousel, and so on. Blogger Roosh V, pickup artist in the manosphere who dabbles in the alt-right, instructs other men how to pick up women. He wrote a book called Bang. Roosh refers to others in the manosphere, like men's rights activists and men growing their own way, as sexual losers and bitter virgins. Roosh's blog, Return of Kings, features articles like Biology Says People on Welfare Should Die, and Five Reasons to Date a Girl with an Eating Disorder. Roosh was excited by Trump's election because he, quote, rates women on a scale of 1 to 10 and evaluates women by their appearance and feminine attitude. He wrote a post titled How to Stop Rape, in which his solution was to legalize rape. Roosh says, my default opinion of any girl I meet is worthless dirty whore until proven otherwise. In this arena, a whore or slut are, ironically, names you give to women who don't sleep with you. A popular website, A Voice for Men, features articles such as 13 Reasons Women Lie About Rape. Ironically, the site's founder, Paul Elam, abandoned two ex-wives and their children, and the only way he can run his website full-time is with the support of these women. Elam often complains of the unfairness of men paying child support. In a post about rape, Elam says, a lot of women get pummeled and pumped because they are stupid, and have signs saying, I'm a stupid, conniving bitch, please rape me. Among the group men going their own way, there are levels. Level zero is taking the red pill and rejecting feminism, and it goes all the way up to level four, where the man refuses to interact with all of society because it has been poisoned by feminism. Many in the manosphere have legitimate complaints. The sexual revolution has resulted in the decline of traditional marriage, and that has changed the nature of sexual selection. Nagel says this has produced a sexual hierarchy, which created a, quote, greater level of sexual choice for an elite men and a growing celibacy among a larger male population at the bottom of the pecking order. Author Thomas Frank wrote, we cannot admit that we liberals bear some of the blame for its emergence. For the frustration of working class millions, for their blighted cities and their downward spiraling lives. So much easier to scold them for their twisted racist souls, to close our eyes to the obvious reality of which Trumpism is just a crude and ugly expression, that neoliberalism has well and truly failed.
When you want to understand what's gone wrong with the Democratic Party, by and large the theme that most people focus on is the money. And this is huge. This is an important part of how the Democratic Party has changed over the years. They, by and large, reach out to the same category of people that the Republican Party reaches out to, you know, their donors and that sort of thing. But there's a larger shift, excuse me, there's a larger shift out there that we don't generally talk about. And that's that the Democratic Party understands itself in a different way today than they did at the time of Franklin Roosevelt, or at the time of Lyndon Johnson, or at the time of Harry Truman, or Hubert Humphrey, or any one of these Democrats of eras past that you care to mention. And that is the Democratic Party today really understands itself, and you hinted at this a minute ago, they understand themselves as the party of the representative of affluent, white-collar professionals. They talk about this all the time, and when they talk about things like innovation, they understand innovation as the property of that class of Americans.
Elitists have long had a Malthusian disdain for the masses, for their culture, their overbreeding, for their very existence. The Malthusian poster of 4chan, Weave, wrote, trolling is basically internet eugenics. Taking it into real life, he said, how do we kill four of the world's 6 billion people in the most just way possible? New atheism was a force that brought people in and slowly moved to the right, becoming fiercely anti-female and anti-social justice warrior. In Fight Club, Tyler Durden gives a critique of the condition of modern men.
God damn it, an entire generation pumping gas, waiting tables, slaves with white collars. Advertising has us chasing cars and clothes, working jobs we hate so we can buy shit we don't need. We're the middle children of history, man. No purpose or place. We have no great war, no great depression. Our great war is a spiritual war. Our great depression is our lives. We've all been raised on television to believe that one day we'd all be millionaires and movie gods and rock stars, but we won't. We're slowly learning that fact. And we're very, very pissed off.
The left typically sees this as an economic critique of neoliberalism, but the right, who has latched onto the movie far more, sees it as a call to return to forgotten masculinity. Both the new right and the new left are very different from their traditional foundations, and where this conflict is headed in the coming years is anybody's guess.